Hi, I'm Dr. Leslie Blankenship-Williams, and in the last lecture, we learned about types of mutations, including point mutations and frameshift mutations. We're going to continue that discussion here with looking at the cause of mutations. So mutations occur during DNA replication, when DNA polymerase makes a mistake. Now, DNA polymerase does not make many mistakes, and bacteria have proofreading abilities once DNA polymerase does finish its replication. The proofreading abilities kind of feel the new double helix and make sure everything fits correctly. And when things don't fit correctly, the proofreading enzymes can identify that as a mistake, excise the mistaken area out, and put in a fresh shot at getting in the correct DNA base. So when mutations do happen, and they do, which is very rare, but if they just happen because DNA polymerase is not perfect and occasionally will make a mistake, we call those spontaneous mutations. To give you an idea of how infrequent spontaneous mutations are, if you take an E. coli cell, one, and you allow it to go through 300 replications, there will be an average of one mutation somewhere in one entire genome, just once. So out of those 300 replications, you get an average of one mutation per E. coli genome. So that's very, very infrequent. So just to summarize, spontaneous mutations are mutations that occur naturally. Okay, we can increase the mutation rate by adding a substance or an agent that causes DNA polymerase to make errors more frequently. These substances or agents are known as mutagens. So mutagens can be both chemical, meaning they can be molecules, or they can be physical, like electromagnetic radiation. So again, these are substances or agents that cause DNA polymerase to make more mistakes than it normally would, and therefore cause more mutations to happen. In the presence of mutagens, when DNA polymerase makes a mutation that it wouldn't normally do, but does because a mutagen is present, those mutations are referred to as induced mutations. So induced mutations can be defined as mutations that occur under the presence of a mutagen. Now, the definition of a mutagen is one that causes induced mutations. So it's a little bit of a circular definition there. But the term mutagen is really a conjunction of mutation and generate. So mutagen, mutation, generate. In other words, something that generates more mutations than normal. In this first lecture, we're going to be looking at chemicals that increase the mutation rate and therefore are chemical mutagens. Before we get into some of the chemical mutagens, let's take a look at what we mean by DNA polymerase making a mistake. So in this diagram here, I have a double-stranded DNA molecule, which is shown here. And then you can see I've blown up part of it and opened it up as if we were getting ready to do DNA replication. So DNA polymerase is this blue enzyme that I've got an arrow to now. And DNA polymerase is running along and basically adding complementary bases. And we learned in a previous lecture that A is always going to pair with T, and C is always going to pair with G. Now the reason why these pair together has to do with the way that A and T fit together. So when you have an adenine base, thymine fits with it really nicely and forms nice hydrogen bonds. When you have cytosine, guanine fits really nicely with it and forms three pairs of hydrogen bonds. So you can think about these as like puzzle pieces almost. And so in this diagram here, down at the bottom, I have a blow up of a part of a DNA strand with five bases, guanine, cytosine, adenine, thymine, and guanine again. And you can see the cutouts, and then you can see that there are extra DNA bases just floating around in the cytosol for DNA polymerase to grab and try to match. So we can go ahead and do that rather quickly. So you can see I've matched C to G, G to C, T to A. Now the way DNA polymerase does this is it basically grabs a random base and tries to fit it with the existing base on the other strand. And it just keeps grabbing them until it gets the right fit. I'll show you what I mean with this last T. So you can see in that video, it tried all the different bases, but only A formed a nice fit with T, and so that's the one it kept. So the reason why I go through this example is because mutagens will often alter some part of the DNA base, such that the fits no longer work very well. I'll use this analogy to describe what I mean. Imagine that you are working on a puzzle, and you have a puzzle piece and you have another puzzle piece and you swear they should go together. But when you try to put them together, their fit just isn't quite right. But maybe that's because there's an error in the manufacturer, you say, and you swear they go together. And of course, down the line, it turns out they don't go together. And the piece you really were looking for was somewhere else. But for a while, you were like, it's not quite right, but maybe it's just as a poor puzzle piece. I don't know. And DNA polymerase can run into the same problems when some part of a puzzle piece is kind of like a little bit wonky and it can't quite get a good fit. So let me give you an example of what I am referring to. Imagine that we have thymine and adenine, which should go together like two puzzle pieces. But I take adenine and I alter it somehow. So this would be like taking a puzzle piece and kind of like cutting part of it off. Mutagens will often alter the chemical base in a way that no longer makes it fit correctly. So let's say that I have a mutagen that does something to the adenine so that part of it gets shaved off, like so. Well, now we know that this is no longer going to fit. You can see no fit there. So what would DNA polymerase do if it came across this thymine, but all the adenines looked like this? Well, it might put the adenine there, or it might put something else there. Nothing is going to fit perfectly. So DNA polymerase tries, using the example I just showed you, by just trying grabbing a bunch and like, does this fit? Does this fit? And of course, nothing is going to fit. So eventually, it just makes its best guess and moves on. And here, in my example, the best guess is actually guanine. So now you can see that where there should have been adenine, there is guanine, and that would be an example of a point mutation. We are going to look at three classes of chemical mutagens. I'll go ahead and list them here. You are responsible for knowing whether or not they create point mutations or frameshift mutations, and you are responsible for understanding the mechanism of action. Now, the mechanism of action is basically how they cause these induced mutations. So the three classes are going to be what are called base analogs, deaminating agents, and acridine dyes. Okay, let's get started with base analogs. Okay, so let's start with nitrogenous base analogs. A nitrogenous base analog is a mimic of a real nitrogenous base. So in DNA, the nitrogenous bases are A, C, G, and T. On the left-hand side, we have T, or thymine. A mimic for thymine, or an analog for thymine, like to be analogous to, is 5-bromouracil. And if you take a look at these chemical structures closely, I'll go ahead and circle the nitrogenous base areas. You'll notice that they are identical except at one position, and that's the bottom of the ring. So you'll notice that on the left here, thymine has a methyl group, where on the right, there is a bromine. Now, bromine is a halogen. It's like fluorine and chlorine and iodine, and it's very electronegative. It's an electron hog. CH3 is not. So by replacing CH3 with bromine, you've altered the dynamics of how the electrons move around, and therefore how hydrogen bonds might want to form. So let's use this example to demonstrate how an analog can be a mutagen or cause a mutation. Imagine that I have a 5-base-long section of DNA, and the sequence is G, A, T, and C. And I'm DNA polymerase, and I'm going to go ahead and run along and find the matches. Now, in my solution, somebody has added a bunch of 5-bromouracil instead of thymine. So in my solution, I have a lot of A's, I have a lot of C's, I have a lot of G's running around, and I might even have an occasional T, but not very many of them, relative to the amount of 5-bromouracil I have. So I'm just going to put BR for 5-bromouracil in its place. Okay, DNA polymerase comes along and basically says, I see a G there, and so I'm going to go ahead and add a C. And then I'm going to come up, and I should be adding a T, but I happen to grab a 5-bromouracil, and it fits in really well there instead. At least well enough. And now I'm going to move over and put an A there. And now I'm going to come over and put a G there. And now I come over and, you know what, I finally grabbed this T that was hanging off to the side and I put it in there. So you wouldn't necessarily put 5-bromouracil every place where a T should be, but you might start putting it in some of the places where a T should be. So what happens is on the next replication cycle, this DNA is separated. And when it's separated, we now have on the top strand here a C, B, R, A, G, and T. Okay, so now that I've separated it, I'm going to go ahead and say DNA polymerase is trying to match this one. And it comes here, and it has no idea what to do with it. A really doesn't fit right. And it just kind of guesses and maybe throws up. Sometimes it might throw in A, like it should, but sometimes it might throw in OG instead, and it moves on. So now we have a point mutation. So nitrogenous-based analogs work by mimicking the real base. And if they are added to a solution where bacteria are growing, then the nitrogenous-based analogs will accidentally get inserted in the place of the real nitrogenous base while that DNA is replicating. And by the second replication, it leads to permanent point mutations. So the outcome here is point mutation. Okay, let's take a look at another type of chemical mutagen. These ones are called deaminating agents. Now the word deaminating, it has D, which means like to be not or remove something. And then you might recognize that it has this little word here that looks like amine, which looks a whole lot like maybe it was an amino group. Amine usually refers to something with nitrogen. Deaminating agents take away an NH2 group and add in its place a double bond to an O, also known as a ketone. So in this case, you can see that the NH2 gets substituted for an O and an NH2 gets substituted for an O. So these are referred to as deaminating agents. An example of a deaminating agent is nitrous acid, which is HNO2. And the mechanism of action is very similar to what I described at the beginning of this lecture using the puzzle piece. So remember, I had an adenine and then I cut off part of the adenine and shaved it off and then it didn't fit with anything. And that's basically what happens here. You change the chemical structure and now you've got these puzzle pieces that don't fit anything. So when you have a puzzle piece that doesn't fit anything, DNA polymerase tries to find that complement and it can't, nothing fits. And finally it throws something in there randomly and you have a point mutation. Deaminating agents also lead to point mutations. The last one that I want to talk about is a group called acridine dyes. And acridine dyes are basically these three ring structures that insert themselves into an existing double helix in a way that obscures bases. So you can see that here. So we have normal DNA up here. And then you've got this acridine dye that kind of gets in here. And notice what it does. It wedges itself somewhere in the DNA base. Now, what's not shown here very, very well is that these kind of block regions. And so what happens is it adds extra bulk into the DNA double helix. When DNA polymerase comes along, it sees a G, and then a T, and then an A, and then a C, and then it sees something here. And it doesn't know what it is, but it knows that there's clearly something there, so it guesses, and it throws something in there, like an A, and then it keeps reading. So by throwing something else in there, DNA polymerase is fooled into thinking there's actually a base there, and it just throws an additional base, or two, or three in. And consequently causes insertions. So we know that insertions lead to frame shift mutations. Which are usually quite problematic. Okay, that concludes our discussion of chemical mutagens. In the next lecture, we'll look at physical mutagens. Thanks.